Hello, class. We're going to be going over Is This the Best Painting in History by Evan Puschak. He is also goes by Nerdwriter. He is a YouTube, I guess, personality? I don't even know. I would say he's a critical theorist. Anyways, I love his channel, so check it out. I don't get any money from him or anything, but he is a popular YouTuber who gets a lot of views, so check him out. He's got a number of videos. He talks about pop culture, all that fun stuff. I talked about it a little bit, right? But I feel like I really want to talk today about how I really love YouTube as a platform. There's a lot out there, don't get me wrong, that may be considered trash, or like you would have to really use your critical discernment with. I really like Nerdwriter because he is... creates what he terms video essays about really interesting topics, right? He also has one about Socrates, the death of Socrates, which is another beautiful painting. I highly recommend that video. But what we're looking at today, obviously, for the sake of this assignment and for the start of this class, is one of the third theorists I want you to look at is Las Meninas, of course, okay? When you are studying this video, and this is what we're going to do today, I'm trying to run this as a... would run if I had you in my classroom, okay? What I mean by that is normally I would have the video showing, I would pause it at certain points, tell you what I think, ask questions. Obviously, can't create that kind of dialogue, but I'm doing my best to let you know, hey, I want to pause here, I want to look at what Puschak does here, right? Not everything I'm saying is exhaustive. It's not the only thing I want you to get from the video. I want you to also use your critical discernment and your critical lens, but I want you to be very mindful of how Puschak introduces this kind of his critical interjecting into the painting, especially with a focus on the three rhetorical appeals of ethos, pathos, and logos. Again, we're being focused here, thinking of our essay, okay? But I really want you, when you watch this, to notice how he uses not only images, obviously video is a visual medium, but we are also, he's a master editor. He chops up the painting in interesting ways, right? He also uses music to a very certain effect, okay? And I want you to think about this, right? I'll pause it specifically a part at the end where I feel like his thesis is coming in or his purpose, and you'll notice the music change, right? He uses zoom ins, he zooms out. So we'll look at that. I want you to really take a look at that. Even if I don't pause it at a certain point in the video, I want you to still make a note of that. Let's go ahead and start the video, and then I'll pause it here and there to discuss.
There's maybe no painting in the history of the form more worthy of analysis than Diego Velázquez's Las Meninas. What we're talking about here is a masterwork by an artist late in his life, but at the height of his powers, determined to drive into this canvas the sum total of his talent, his experience, and his intellect. Velázquez had been, by then, a court painter for the Spanish King Philip IV for over 30 years. Indeed, he was a favorite of Philip's, painting his portrait many times and advancing in salary and rank all the way up to Chamberlain of the Palace, responsible for decorating this great Alcazar of Madrid with all its many artworks. So it's no surprise...
I want to pause here and I want us to think about creating touch points with what Puschak does here, and what Lesser does in her article, and what Steele does in his poem, right? Here, this early part of the video, we see biography and context. Immediately, I'm already thinking of this as connected to Lesser. Lesser gives us a better painting of the man, or not better, but a different angle. Puschak, when presenting this information, or Nerdwriter, maybe I'll say that a little bit easier, or maybe it'll be a little bit easier if I say Nerdwriter, he introduces biography and context as well, so we can create that touch point, right? It's not as in-depth, I would say, as Lesser gives, right? But we still are kind of touching on that same question that Lesser asks. Why does this painting still mystify? Why are we still talking about this three centuries later, right? Something that Puschak will touch on as well. So let's continue the vid.
Is that for his masterpiece, Velázquez sets his painting in the palace itself, the place he knew best, specifically in his own studio, adorned with paintings that he himself chose. Now, they're a little bit hard to see, but we know what they are based on histories of the space, and it's no accident that he chooses these paintings specifically, but we'll get to that a bit later. First, let's take a look at the main action of the scene. So much hits you right away. Maybe the first thing you see is the little girl, Margaret Teresa, the then only living child of the king. Or maybe you see that mirror showing reflected images of the king and queen themselves. Or maybe the first thing that stands out to you is that six of the nine characters represented here are staring beyond the picture plane, which is to...
I want to pause it here as well, and I want to share that this is really interesting, this part of the video, to me, because... And that's why I framed this early response to Las Meninas. I didn't want you to have, and I waited on the video and I waited on the article and the poem. I didn't want you to have a kind of, and maybe you could have even Googled it or studied before, which was fine. But that's funny because now I'm seeing connections between what you were talking about in your discussion post, right? Some of you were intent on looking at the Infanta, it's her name in the front, right? The princess. Some of you were intent on looking at Diego Velázquez, but not just Velázquez, the emblem on his chest. Really good critical close readings. The mirror in the back, which we see Steele will mention specifically. Lesser talks about as well. Puschak will talk about this very in-depth here in a minute. But it's really interesting where, you know, we can start seeing how this painting has so many draw-ins, I like to call them, or what we're looking at. Well, like he will call this the eye of the painting, and he'll discuss this a little further. But I really feel that's powerful to think about how many different ideas were presented here, and it could give you an idea of what Velázquez was aiming for. Let's continue on.
Say, at you. That fact alone gives this image its great sense of spontaneity, as if it were a snapshot. Velázquez captures the moment just when several of these figures are noticing something. Some, like these three, have yet to notice it. In the case of the little princess, all that's moved so far is her eyes. But though the moment depicted is spontaneous, the composition of the subjects is anything but. You have here a real clinic in composing group scenes. What Velázquez has done in this group of 11, including the mirror images of the king and queen, is arranged an extraordinary number of links and contrasts that slides your eyes back and forth across the canvas. The first thing to notice, perhaps, is the obsession here with grouping twos and threes. Everyone here but the princess can be split into pairs, the male and female dwarf, the two chaperones here, the curtsying maid and the palace official in the back corridor, the king and the queen in the mirror, and Velázquez and the maid kneeling to offer the princess a drink. Notice also that these are all male-female pairs, and these pairings accentuate the princess as the focus of the scene. But you could also split the group up into threes. The princess with her two maids, the dog and the two dwarves, and the two palace officials with what now occurs to us are mirrored couples. See also that these two groups of three, internally made up of doubles and triples, are all on the same horizontal plane. This group of six also draws the entirety of the painting's three-dimensional space. Our eye is drawn from Velázquez in the foreground to the palace official in the distance as they're wearing similar black garb and stand in line with the two doorways on the back walls. The chaperones in the middle ground link to the king and queen in the background, which simultaneously brings the Z-axis all the way forward beyond the picture itself, intimating a depth that we can't even see. It's amazing.
I want to pause here. I agree, that is amazing, and I love the way Puschak uses that eye image to draw you in, the way he's following the image, right? And I want you to think about how different it would be if it was just an essay. And we already read an article about Lesser, we've read the poem about Lesser. I really love what Puschak does there, because he has your eye follow where that eye is going, and then also how it draws you in. It's an awesome effect, and I love that he uses that for a critical effect, right? Let's think about this here. Move forward.
What you might not have realized is that this motif of twos and threes has already been established in the frames on the back wall, with two giant canvases over top two door frames and the central mirror. Of that bottom triple, the right sides of the frames correspond with the princess and her two maids, moving the eyes naturally from the king and queen to their daughter. But the eyes are also drawn from the mirror to the right, that lighted passage framing the palace official. The space of this lighted rectangle is equal to that of the mirror, and they're put on the same horizontal plane as well. Indeed, because of its brightness, like the brightness of the little princess bathed in light, we're drawn to it just as much as the other two. In these three elements of Las Meninas, we have three central focus points. Unlike Da Vinci's Last Supper, for example, where all elements in the painting point toward Jesus Christ, Las Meninas is more ambiguous, letting the viewer vacillate between multiple centers of weight. Being a court painter for the royal family, it's obvious why Velázquez would want to highlight the royal couple and their daughter. But what's significant about the back hallway? Well, this gets at a long-running debate about the significance of this mirror. What exactly is it reflecting? A number of critics have seen it as the reflection of the actual king and queen, standing, like we said, beyond the picture plane, putting the viewer literally in the shoes of royalty.
I want to pause there because I want you to think about Steele, who specifically says this, right? He says what? We reflected as the king and queen, okay? So he's making that claim. Puschak will push back a little bit on this, and I want you to think about this argument. It is easy to say that this back mirror is reflecting us, the viewers, as king and queen, but Puschak says something different here, okay? So we can see these different argumentations about the painting here. Let's think about this.
But a closer examination of the one-point perspective of this image reveals something else. The vanishing point of Las Meninas is not here, but here, in the lighted doorway to the right. Now, what does this mean? Well, it means that the eye of this painting, so to speak, isn't opposite the mirror, but opposite the door. So the mirror doesn't reflect directly back at us, it reflects at an angle that puts its image on another unseen aspect of Las Meninas, the canvas that Velázquez is working on. Now, for a moment, let's get back to the paintings in the upper half of this picture. These are copies of two paintings by Peter Paul Rubens, a hero of Velázquez, and they tell similar stories, in this case both from Ovid's Metamorphosis. In the right, the mortal Marsyas challenges the god Apollo to a flute-playing contest. In the left, the god Athena challenges the mortal Arachne to a weaving contest. In other words, these are two contests between mortals and gods on the subject of the arts. Marsyas loses and Arachne wins, but both are punished by their gods in the end for failing to recognize the divine source of the artistic endeavor. Such stories are extremely relevant to Las Meninas because in the end, this is a painting about painting itself.
I want to pause here. Not only is Ovid's Metamorphosis collection of stories one of my favorite works of literature ever, I love that Puschak is calling this to attention, right? And I want to, this is where we can really think about what he's doing here in the terms of either ethos or logos, or maybe even pathos, but I think pathos argumentation may come sooner, right? And this is something I want you to specifically think about. He is using Ovid's Metamorphosis, but not only the story, that is a piece of literature, right? But these are paintings done by a painter under the that goes by the name of, Peter Paul Rubens, who was a big influence on Diego Velázquez. Okay, so I want you to think about that as well, right? This is a form of ethos, maybe, and this kind of credibility. If in fact Puschak is making the claim for the that this painting is kind of valorizing the art of, this painting is a valorization of the art of painting itself, we can think of why he has these in the background, right? This is what is called a rhetorical choice. We've discussed this a little bit, but just as you write an article, just as a article is written for you, this was chosen by Velázquez, and that's something to think about, right? That is, I could make a claim, maybe that is an ethos argument, right? That is an ethical argument. It is based in credibility, right? Logos, from a logical perspective, right? I like this idea as well, okay? Is it logical that this painting that has come before and this painting here now proves then that painting has much more to say or is much more than this kind of way to paint, like, and I kind of make fun of this, but the way to paint kings and queens selfies, right? back before selfies were a thing, but that's basically what they were. If you think of that early painting of Velázquez that was shown in this video here, it is just him by himself. He did a lot of paintings that way. This one is a stark, in stark contrast to what that is, right? And you can think about why Steele titled his poem Siglo de Oro and why this time period was called the Spanish Golden Age of Art. What is Diego Velázquez doing here to upend or challenge or question, critically have the reader or the viewer, excuse me, examine this painting? Okay, a lot to be said there. And I really love this, what Puschak is doing there. And this really, when I first saw this, really opened my eyes, because this is a very critical argument. Okay, hopefully you follow along with that, but hopefully this will make a little bit more sense. I'll kind of wrap it up here. Let's go.
In Velázquez's time, painting still didn't hold the same kind of noble place as poetry and music. Las Meninas, in all its splendid effects, is a vigorous argument for the virtue of painting, whether it comes from the heaven.
Gotta pause there. There it is, right? It is a vigorous argument for the virtue of painting. Powerful words there, right? Powerful words.
Heavens, or from the lifelong practice of craft. And this gets at the heart of the mirror, the vanishing point, and the multiple centers of focus.
Here, Puschak brings it all together. There's a lot of what here. What the painting is, what is done. Now, I feel this is his critical insertion. This is where it's happening. This is where he's bringing the why and why it matters. And also returning to this critical question, is this the best painting in history? That is a strong question. That's a strong assertion. He, in my opinion, and you can disagree, is backing that up with this 9-minute video. Let's take a look.
See what my art can do, Velázquez is saying to the viewer. And to his king and queen, look not to nature or your own reflection in the mirror for the most marvelous depiction of your image, but to my canvas. Las Meninas is an extraordinary accomplishment for its time, but its effect is timeless.
Let's pause here because I want you to hear the music change. That's something minor, but that's pretty major in this piece. Let's go back about 10 seconds. Let's see if we can hear the music change.
But to my canvas,
let's go back a little bit.
From the lifelong practice of craft. And this gets at the heart of the mirror, the vanishing point, and the multiple centers of focus. See what my art can do, Velázquez is saying to the viewer. And to his king and queen, look not to nature or your own reflection in the mirror for the most marvelous depiction of your image, but to my canvas. Las Meninas is an extraordinary accomplishment for its time, but its effect is timeless. It's said that King Philip IV often came to Velázquez's studio just to watch him paint. Somehow I think Las Meninas animated his consciousness as it does mine 360 years later. Indeed, to stare at this painting in any age is to be convinced slowly, gradually, and then confidently that you are witnessing the very best this medium has to offer. Hey everybody, thanks for watching.
Gonna pause there. We don't need to hear his. You could check that out, obviously. You've probably seen it already. Yeah, so that's it, right? This is the video. This is a strong example of how to present an argument. In my opinion, he's doing something very critical here, right? And I want you to dissect that a little bit further. This is just me kind of walking you through that. But I also want to emphasize here, this is not me saying this is the strongest piece by any means, right? As you've seen in Steele, Siglo de Oro, you can see that there is a resemblance, right? We're going to talk about resemblance claims in the next one. But there's a resemblance into what they're arguing. But these are three different styles of engaging this center focus of critical analysis.